Because he lives, I can face this tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds the future. And life is worth the living just because.
Morning, all. Do we have any guests here this morning? Hi, welcome. I think I saw some hands over there as well. Welcome to you as well. On this side, none. Okay. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, thank you that we can come before you today, on a day that we celebrate what you have done for us. Thank you that you died on the cross and that you rose again to save each of us. Lord, as we go into the service, Lord, help us to focus on you and what you have done for each of us. In your precious name, amen. I'm going to light the candle in remembrance of God, who is with us, as a symbol of that he's here today.
As Jean lights the candle, I'm going to invite us to stand together and worship the Lord our God.
O Lord my God, when I in awesome wonder consider all the works thy hands have made, I see the stars.
Hosanna.
I will follow him. Follow him wherever he may go. And near him I always will be. I will follow him. Ever since he touched my heart and you, there isn't an ocean too deep, a mountain so high it can keep me away, away from his love. I love him.
Seated. Thank you. If you've ever gone to a Resurrection Sunday morning service, there is a phrase or a couple of words I say, and then you need to respond. I'm not going to tell you what it is. We're going to try this out. Christ is risen.
Christ is risen.
Really? If that's how Christ is risen, then I'm going to go back to sleep. We're going to try this again. Christ is risen. Indeed, he has. Amen. Thanks be to God for this morning, a worship service in which we celebrate that Christ is risen indeed, and a celebration service where we acknowledge all that Christ has done for us. And so I need to say welcome to everybody. I want to share that Friday, Good Friday, we do a collection on that day. In this service, we collected over 5,700 rand that goes towards the Ministerial Student Fund for the training and formation of ministers. And then I'm not quite sure in the three-hour service what was collected there. Lali? 19. So that gets paid to the circuit, and then the seven churches in our circuit pays over to MCO, the Methodist Church, for the training and formation of ministers in training. And so we give God the honor and the glory for that. Amen. This coming week, we've got Friends Who Care meeting, and we've got our Jolly Jumblers. And so just another notice, if you haven't yet sorted out your cupboards and need to get rid of stuff, the Jolly Jumblers are looking for clothing, shoes, bedding, linen, and that can be dropped off at the church office anytime through the week or on Sunday, and then that will go probably to the next month's collection. Is there any good news to share other than Christ is risen? Ty? That's not good news. I'm not in your suitcase. You didn't even invite me with you. Okay, so you guys are going to Brazil tomorrow. Okay. We will pray for safe travel mercies and that you guys come home to us. Amen. Linda? Oh, wow. There we go. Congratulations. Anybody else celebrating a wedding anniversary? A birthday? Good news? So you've got him home for a week, another week to go, and then you're shipping him off for 8 weeks. John, I'm sorry, but I hear that when you come back, then you're getting rid of your wife for 3 months. I'm not going to say that's good news, but the fact that you are here today, we celebrate that. Lali? Delise's birthday today. Another birthday. Good day. JJ? Son was in hospital but has now been discharged. Amen. We continue to pray for God's healing. Kathy? Taylor in New Zealand, day after tomorrow, turns one. All right. Fiji for her birthday. She must go say hello to my brother-in-law. Please. All right. Any other good news? Any prayer requests? Prayer needs? So you've got everything that you need and require. Everybody's healthy and strong in your family, so you don't need prayer needs. Okay. Karen? So for those traveling, returning home, but also for those that have lost loved ones over this Easter weekend. Absolutely. I did see another hand. Millie? Okay, so your sister-in-law and brother-in-law traveling down to the Cape. And for your sister, sister-in-law. Thank you. Peter? Okay, so successful knee op for Jackie, and we just continue to pray that she receives full healing and restoration. Amen. Shall we pray together? Gracious Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to gather together. We celebrate with those celebrating a wedding anniversary, for those celebrating birthdays. Lord God, we are mindful of those that are going to be traveling on the roads and just pray for safe traveling mercies. We are mindful over this weekend already that there have been some horrific fatal accidents, and we just pray for those that are left behind for comfort and for strength. Lord, we thank you that over this weekend, people, families have gathered together and shared together and celebrated, and I honestly believe families don't do that enough. And so, Lord God, we just pray for your touch. We pray for Millie's sister-in-law and brother-in-law as they travel down to the Cape to the other sister-in-law, that's not well at the moment, and just pray for your safe traveling mercies, for your healing, for the outpouring of your Spirit. We thank you for the opportunity for Ty and CJ as they travel to Brazil. Just ask for safe traveling mercies and that they return back to us safely. Thank you that Jackie's operation was a success. And we just ask, Lord, that as she is home and recovering, that you would allow her to experience your strength, your healing, your power. We give you honor and praise, and we glorify your holy name, acknowledging, Lord God, that we humbly come to you, trusting in your mercy and in your grace, trusting that when we confess, you are faithful and you are just, and that you do forgive us and purify us from all unrighteousness. And so, Lord God, we are reminded of the prayer that you taught your disciples, a prayer that we now say together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'm going to ask those that are assisting me with Holy Communion to please come forward. And so we know that on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took water and started to wash the feet of his disciples. Symbolic and symbolizing that through Jesus, we are washed clean, that we are purified, that we are made worthy, and we are made holy. And so we come not because we are deserving, but because of what Jesus Christ has done for us. A gift given to all of humanity for the forgiveness of our transgressions and our sins. We do this as we prepare for a sacred moment, a holy moment, in which we acknowledge Jesus Christ as Lord and as Savior, King of all the world. And so in this moment, we acknowledge a sacrament. We acknowledge the gift of Holy Communion. We acknowledge God's love poured out in a visible form, in the form of Jesus Christ. He chose the cross. He chose the suffering. He chose crucifixion. He chose death so that you and I might be able to share in this gift, in which we are reminded of his blood spilled for us. So on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread, offered it to God, gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take, eat, this is my body, broken for you." In the same way, at the end of the meal, Jesus took the cup, offered it to God, gave thanks, blessed it, and gave it to his disciples, saying to them, "Take and drink. This is the cup of the new covenant, made in my blood for you and for many for the forgiveness
of sins. Let us pray together. Father God, we humbly come and we surrender ourselves, our will, to you, O Lord. And in this moment, Father God, we thank you for your love. In this moment, Jesus Christ, we thank you for your sacrifice. In this moment, we invite you, Holy Spirit, not just to bless us, but to come down upon these elements, allowing them to become for us the body of Christ and the blood of Christ, that we may share together, that we may be united together, that we may truly be blessed. We ask and pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Going to invite our stewards to usher you forward. The table of the Lord is open to all. As visitors, you are welcome to share in the table. You will come forward. If you would like to kneel, you may. If you'd like to stand, you may. And you just put your hands in front of you. You will receive your wafer. You may eat the wafer, and then someone will bring you the juice. And once you receive that, then you may drink the juice as well. If there are members in the congregation that are not able to come forward, I will be coming through and serving those in their seats. Thank you.
Let us pray. Loving Lord, we thank you for this gift and for this blessing and for this privilege that we are united with you and with all those that have gone before us and all those that will follow after us. May you continue to work in our lives. May you continue to challenge us to be better. We ask and pray all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. Thank you to the worship team. Thank you to the stewards.
Good morning, everyone. So I asked this question at the sunrise service. That's why I look half asleep, is because I've been awake all morning. We've already had a sunrise service. You guys feel like the evening service. So I asked this question at the sunrise service, and I was quite surprised by the answer, so I'm going to ask this question now. Who has had coffee already this morning? Okay, a few of us. I have a confession to make. I was actually drinking coffee on stage earlier on. Oh, sorry, Corin. The second question I asked, and I was even more surprised by this answer, is who's had chocolate already today? A few of us have had chocolate. Wow, quite a lot of us have had chocolate. I'll never forget the one Easter Sunday service when I was still in Benoni. One of the little children had had so much chocolate that they got sick at the 8 o'clock service. And I was like, how much chocolate have you had? It's quite an exciting morning this morning, isn't it? Can you remember Easter when you were a little child? Can you remember that? You used to wake up looking for the Easter eggs, and they would like be hidden all over the place, and you'd go and have an Easter egg hunt. Can you remember how exciting Easter was as a child? Or who still finds it exciting like that? Who here has had an Easter egg hunt already? Oh, you see, I knew there would be some people. It's very exciting. Charlie, getting Easter eggs at church doesn't count as an Easter egg hunt. You had to look for them. Easter morning is so exciting. There's something about it. It's this incredible moment where you wake up and it's just got this feeling of exuberance, of life. At the end of the day, this is the day where everything changed. This is the day that sets Christianity apart from anything else. It's the day that our Savior who died showed that death is nothing to worry about. He showed that at the end of death, there is life. Bearing that in mind, I want us to read from John chapter 20. I'm going to read this story, and I want you to imagine this is the first time you've ever heard it. You know, sometimes when we hear stories a number of times, they become so normal to us that we don't actually hear how incredible it is. So as I read this story, imagine this is the first time you've ever heard it. I can tell you now, it will be unbelievable. This is what it says from verse 1. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene went to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the entrance. So she came running to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one Jesus loved, which is John, by the way, and he wrote this gospel. That's why you can see he says, the one that Jesus loved, me, is what he's saying. And said, they have taken the Lord out of the tomb and we don't know where they have put him. So Peter and the other disciples started for the tomb. Both were running, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent over and looked in at the strips of linen lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter, who was behind him, arrived and went into the tomb. He saw the strips of linen lying there, as well as the burial cloth that had been around Jesus' head. The cloth was folded up by itself, separate from the linen. Finally, the other disciple who had reached the tomb first also went inside. He saw and believed. They still did not understand from Scripture that Jesus had to rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes, but Mary Mary stood outside the tomb crying. As she wept, she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white seated where Jesus' body had been, one at the head and the other at the foot, and they asked her, "Woman, why are you crying?" "They have taken my Lord away," she said, "and I don't know where they've put him." At this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing there, but she did not realize that it was Jesus. "Woman," he said, "why are you crying? Who is it that you're looking for?" Thinking he was the gardener, she said, Sir, if you've carried him away, tell me where you've put him and I will go and get him." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned around and cried out in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. Thanks be to God for his word. Can you imagine that first moment where Mary, who is so upset because the person she loves, the person who's changed her life, this Jesus who was the first person to ever welcome her in his presence and make her feel like a human being, make her feel loved and accepted, the one who set her free, the one who set her free from everything that ever tortured her, and now he is dead. And she goes to the tomb to look after his body, and he's gone. She waits and cries, willing to go and carry his body back. I don't know how she was going to carry his body, a woman on her own. I don't know how she was going to carry his body back, and she didn't know how, but that's what she wanted. She just wanted to see Jesus one more time. Can you imagine? And then imagine her joy when she turns around and she's speaking to Jesus through tears, and he says her name. He just says, "Mary," and she goes like, "Lord." Can you imagine? Unbelievable, isn't it? That's why this morning is such an incredible morning. That's why Easter morning has this feeling of life and goodness and love, is because that's what it was. But I've been thinking, imagine what Easter morning, imagine what this morning must feel like in Israel today. I saw a picture of, the old Jerusalem has four quarters, and there's a Jewish quarter and a Christian quarter, and the Christian quarter is all closed up for Easter weekend, which it would be on Good Friday. And I saw that picture, and I just thought, imagine what Easter morning must feel like in Israel today. Just picture it. Must be the sense of, like, excitement but fear. Imagine what Easter must feel like for the Christians stuck in the Gaza Strip. They don't even have food, let alone Easter eggs. That feeling of like, will we make today? Will we make today? It's Easter there. Imagine what Easter must feel like in Ukraine. Russia. Yeah, we have Christians all over the world, and for some of them, their Easter morning is not like ours, is it? Even in South Africa, one of our colleagues recently, I think it was a week or two ago, very, very incredible minister. I really am so fond of this guy. He's the most gentle-spirited person I've ever met. And seven armed gunmen walked into his church and opened fire while he was preaching. Even in South Africa, can you imagine what Easter feels like for some people? Now imagine, just for a second, I know I'm talking a lot about imagining. We'll get to the point. Imagine for a minute there was a country or a place. Imagine there was a place where everyone had enough. Wouldn't it be nice? Imagine there was a place where every person had enough food to eat, that no one person went hungry. And I don't just mean food as in, like, I don't know, chips. I mean food as in good food, nourishing food, fresh food. fresh vegetables. Imagine there was a place where everyone had enough to eat, that not one person could ever say, the favorite word of all teenagers, I'm hungry. Just imagine. Imagine a place where everyone had enough. Imagine a place where nobody walked in fear. Where you could run around, move around. You didn't have to worry. You didn't have to be afraid. Imagine a place where there was no fear whatsoever. Can I ask you this question? When last did you walk somewhere without fear? Have you ever? Have you ever been anywhere where you did not fear? Where you didn't have that feeling of like, Imagine a place like that. That would be nice, wouldn't it? Imagine a place where there was no fear, where everyone had enough, and everyone was equal. None of the some people more important than others. None of the some people better looking than others. None of the some people having a lot and others having nothing. Imagine a place where everyone felt like they belong. Have you ever walked into a place and felt, I don't belong here? I said at the sunrise service, almost every minister's meeting. That's how I feel. Imagine that kind of place. Everyone had enough, where there was no fear, no violence, where everyone was equal, where everyone got along. Would you want to live in a place like that? Anybody want to live there? Yeah, love. The Bible, Scripture actually talks about a place like that. It talks about a place like that that existed. And when I say this, you're all going to be like, oh. It talks about a place like that that existed, and it was right at the beginning of Scripture, the Garden of Eden. You guys get it? Everyone had enough. There was fruit trees everywhere. They could help themselves. There were fresh water rivers running past. They could drink as they like. Nobody lived in any fear. They didn't have shame. They didn't even notice they were running around naked because they did not care. Body shaming was not a thing. They lived in peace and harmony, and everyone got along. Until they didn't. Until that moment where Adam and Eve wasn't the only one to blame, just so by the way, men. She might have been the first, but she wasn't the last to eat that fruit. Until Eve was deceived. And she ate the fruit, and she ate the fruit because she believed it would make her more intelligent. She believed that by eating this fruit, she would be a little bit more like God. She would be able to decide what's right and what's wrong. She would be able to have power over her own life and her own choices. And so she decided, and Adam decided with her, let's eat this fruit. Let's do the one thing God asked us not to do. And that's what happened. Is they so desperately wanted power. They wanted to be God. And everything went pear-shaped after that. Think about it. After that, after they ate the fruit, is what happens is suddenly sin enters this world. Suddenly they realize that they are naked. They hide from God. They live in shame. And what happens after that is suddenly we see how the world starts unraveling. Literally hell on earth. His brother turns against brother and kills each other, Cain and Abel. People become more and more corrupt and evil. They try and build a tower big enough to reach God to prove how strong they are, the Tower of Babel. And everything causes chaos and division. And they are divided and people start fighting each other. And then all of a sudden you see that so many people are corrupt that they're destroying creation. They're destroying each other. And Noah's Ark happens. And after Noah's Ark, we see God trying over and over and over again to reach humanity because humanity has gone so far wrong. And the rest of Scripture is the story about God calling out to people saying, let me be your God again. Let me be your God. Stop trying so hard to be God on this earth and just be my people. And he tries through Noah and Abraham, Isaac, and Elijah, and Isaiah, and Jeremiah, and all of those prophets, and David, and everyone. And God constantly has this message to the people, let me be your God, and you can be my people. Because when I am your God, and you are my people, guess what? Everyone will have enough. There won't be fear. Everyone will be equal. When I am God, and you are my people, that's what happens. But as humans, we're a bit messed up. See, what happens is the minute sin entered this world, this is how humans responded to it. And I want you to think, if you've ever done this, this is what happens. Then the man and his wife, this is Adam and Eve, heard the sound of the Lord God as he was walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and they hid from the Lord God among the trees of the garden. But the Lord God called to the man, where are you? He answered, I heard you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, and so I hid. Have you ever hid from your parents when you knew you were in trouble? Ever done that? Ever try to get away? Adam and Eve, the minute they fell short of this, the minute they allowed this corruption to enter into their hearts and their minds, the minute they tried to be something that they're not, the minute they tried to be God in their own lives and in the garden, that something happens is suddenly they realize that they are naked, and so they're filled with shame. They're filled with shame. And so they hide from God. They're filled with shame. They're filled with guilt. So, Lord, we realized. You know that they're guilty because when God says to Adam, you know, what have you done? He says, well, the woman you put here made me do it. That's a sign of a guilty person, is when they try and blame someone else. They're filled with shame. They're filled with guilt. And they're filled with fear. For the first time ever, they're afraid of God. You know, up until this point, they've walked with God, spoken with God. They had a partnership with God. God showed them the animals and they named them together. And God gave them jobs to do. And up until this moment, they had this like love relationship where they could just be in each other's presence without shame or fear or guilt. But now they're so riddled with guilt and so riddled with shame that they decide to hide from God. And when humanity tried to hide from God, that's when everything went wrong. The rest of the Bible is all about how God tries to get man out of hiding. The rest of the Bible is all about how God tries to get people to come out of hiding. It says, let me be your God again. Can be my people. But what do people do is we try three things. We try and hide from God. Some of us try and hide from God by sounding very intelligent. Oh no, I don't believe in God because God is unbelievable. Well, yes, God is unbelievable. That's why he is God. Yeah, we try and hide from God. Sometimes we try and be God. I'm the Lord of my own life. I will make myself better. All this self-help and self-improvement and, you know, trying to build ourselves up all the time. What about just letting God be God and us be his people? We try and hide from God. We try and be God. We try and impress God. And that's the problem of the church and the problem with religious people. Sometimes we're trying so hard to impress God, and then when God doesn't do what we want to do, we go, but didn't I impress you? I went to church on Sunday. Why have I not got the job on Monday? Yeah, I went to church on Sunday. Why are my children fighting? I prayed today. Did you not hear me? Why are you not doing what I want you to do? And the rest of Scripture is all about how God's trying to get people out of hiding, how God's trying to remove the shame and the guilt. But people, we're trying so hard to be God, and we're trying so hard to impress God, and we're trying so hard to hide from God that all that happens is humanity turns against itself and the rest of creation, and we cause nothing but suffering and pain. And then Jesus arrives. And Jesus arrives, and he arrives in human form so that we cannot hide from him any longer. He arrives in human form, and what does he do? He looks at the people and he says, I know that you are riddled with guilt. I know that you are riddled with guilt, so I will take on a punishment so that you don't have to feel guilty anymore. And he's beaten and crucified. You know why he did that? He did that not because he had to. He did that not because he was forced to. He did that because he wanted to, because God realized the only way that these people can stop hiding from me is if they let go of the guilt. And so I will take a punishment so that you no longer have to sacrifice, thinking that's what will get you to me. So come out of hiding. Stop living in guilt. And he took the shame. You see, we were so filled with shame. That's what sin does to us. Sin causes shame. In the moment when we're tempted, sin looks so inviting. It looks so fantastic. It looks like it's something that will just make our lives fantastic. And at the end of it, we're filled with shame. And shame is that dreaded feeling of, oh my gosh, I'm not as good as I thought I was. Oh my gosh, I suck. How could I have done that? Shame is what Adam and Eve felt when they realized they were naked. That moment of somebody can see everything. Someone can see everything. And they were filled with shame. What does Jesus do? What does God do? God comes in human form and he says, right, if you were so shamed by the fact that I could see everything, if you were so shamed by the fact that you are naked, that I can see everything you've ever done, he says, let me do something for you, is I will be shamed in front of you so that your shame has no power. And he's crucified naked. God does in that moment is God says to us as the people, he says, I will be shamed so that your shame has no power. Just think about that. Just think about that. The King of the universe, the creator of heaven and earth, the one who breathed life into this world, decided to be crucified naked so that our nakedness was no longer shameful. So that we didn't have to feel ashamed and hide. And then the reason they hid, because they were shamed, because they were filled with guilt, they thought and they felt that because of shame and because of guilt, God will strike me dead. And so they hid from God. And that's what we do. I don't know if you've ever done it. I've done it. When I'm filled with guilt and I'm filled with shame, I'm afraid. And so I hide from God. And I try all these excuses of, oh, no, I don't want to pray because God's not answering me. And I don't want to go to church anymore. And I don't want to do these things. And we hide from God because we're actually afraid of facing God. And what does Jesus do? Jesus takes the one thing, or the two things that humanity is the most afraid of, suffering and death. And Jesus says, I will endure it, and I will face it, and I will die so that you have nothing to be afraid of. And he conquers fear. You see, sin leads to fear and shame and guilt. And Jesus Christ rises from the dead to say to us, your shame, I took it for you. Your guilt, I bore it for you. Your death, I've died it for you, so that you can live. And this kingdom that Jesus invites us to is a kingdom of those things. It's a kingdom of the Garden of Eden. It's this kingdom that says that when we realize that we don't have to hide from God and we allow God to be our God and us be his people, something miraculous happens is our heart starts to change and suddenly we will become people that will share what we have. So nobody has nothing and someone has everything. We will become people that care for each other, that don't look down on one another, that doesn't look at somebody and think, you don't belong here, that doesn't judge, but we become people who start living in that kingdom. And the problem with Christianity today is we've become consumers who's all about what can God give me instead of people that say, how can I live in that kingdom? And when we live in that kingdom, every day will be like Easter. It's a scary thought. I want you to think about this just for a minute. Who you are becoming right now, who you are becoming, who I am becoming, is who I will be. Who you are becoming is who you will be. Some of us, we're becoming more like agents of Jesus. And when we allow Jesus to work in our lives, when we allow him to be our God and us his people, guess what? Those things will come naturally. We won't have to force it. But for some of us, we're actually not. We're becoming people who are angry and disappointed and resentful and shameful, and we're hiding from God. And who we're becoming is who we will be. The message of Easter is that Jesus says, will you come out of hiding? You have nothing to fear. Not even death. Not shame, not guilt, not death. You have nothing to fear. Just come out of hiding. Let me be your God so that you can be my people. Just invite us today. Invite us today. Let's stop hiding from God. There is nothing to fear. And guess what? I'm going to close with this statement. It all started with a woman in the form of Eve. Why do you think Jesus appears to a woman in the form of Mary? It started with a woman and it ends with a woman. It is finished. It is finished. We don't have to live in hell on earth. The kingdom of heaven is here. Let us pray. Gracious Father, we just pray that we would have the strength and the courage to stop hiding from you, that we would no longer fear shame or guilt, but that we would live in freedom, that we would be people who like Adam and Eve, can walk with you and talk to you and share with you and partner with you, that we won't be afraid of you, but that we can know that you are with us. That's why you are Jesus, Emmanuel, God with us. May we know today that nothing can separate us from you. Not our guilt, not our shame, not our failures, not our egos. Nothing can separate us from you, not even death. You are with us now and forevermore. May we be people who live in heaven on earth by allowing you to be our God and us be your people. In the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Louise. On Friday morning, we had a cross in the frontier, and we had the opportunity to hammer some nails into that cross, to let go of some things. This morning, we've got a cross here, and there are flowers in the front. And that cross can mean many things to you today. It can remind you of a loved one that is no longer with us. And so you can come and put a flower in the cross. It can remind you of the last 6 weeks, our Lenten journey, where we have taken on spiritual disciplines, spiritual practices, and in those practices, taken on and done new things. And maybe you want to continue doing that. You can put a flower in the cross. Over the Lenten journey, we've invited you to let go of things. Things that have been robbing you. Things that have held you back in your spiritual walk. Maybe you just want to put a flower in there and say, no longer. Now I celebrate. Whatever you want that flower to symbolize for you as you place it in the cross, allow it to do that. The worship team is going to lead us. And I'm not going to end the service. I'm taking the lead from Reverend Louise. She did that on Friday afternoon. I'm going to ask our stewards to come collect the collection bags. And they're going to stand, I think, at these two exits. And as you have put your flower in, you are welcome to leave. The worship team, they're going to continue. They're not allowed to leave. Jammer vir julle. If you want to put a flower in and then sit for a while, you're welcome to do that. But this moment after I've prayed is the actual closing. And then there is tea and coffee available. Shall we pray together? Lord God, we acknowledge this journey that we've been on over 6 weeks, spiritual discipline, spiritual practices, fasting, praying, worship, letting go and taking on. And so, Lord God, as we celebrate your resurrection, as we celebrate life, we celebrate that we no longer have to hide, but that we can live knowing that we are redeemed, knowing that we are forgiven, knowing that there is no shame that you have not dealt with. And so, Lord God, we remember those that have gone before us, our loved ones. We remember those things that we have let go of, that hold on to us no longer. And today, we celebrate the beauty and the life given to us through Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Bless us, Lord. May we continue to honor you and glorify you. We ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Mm-hmm.